is Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive Magazine. Excuse the hoarse voice. It is great to be back on a Monday night hanging out with you guys talking about the guitar. Today, we are discussing how you can set some reasonable goals to make the most out of your guitar playing in 2022. It is the new year, of course. Happy New Year to all our returning viewers. And if you're just joining us for the first time, thanks for coming on board. It's really great to have you along. We're going to be talking about all sorts of good stuff today, and I'm hopefully going to be equipping you guys with some tools for both goal setting and also achieving said goals. Now, I'm going to apologize for missing last week. I do love these Monday sessions, but unfortunately, the plague got me. And you can probably hear I'm still just a little bit hoarse, and if I'm coughing a little bit, don't worry, I'm absolutely fine. I promise I'm in fine health, but just sound a little bit husky. But anyway, we're going to be talking about all that good stuff, but before we do that, let's just check in with the stream, because we have a wealth of comments already, all sorts of stuff going on. Let's see who's tuning in. Our friend Marcin is joining us. Marcin is a regular, a friend of the stream, as we like to call him. Fine guitar player too. It's great to have you on board. Blue Sumlin is joining us. Says, hi Nick and everyone, happy new year. It's great to have you on board, Blue Sumlin. Happy new year to you too as well. Hope you had a really great festive period. Kim is tuning in from a sunny part of the world. Spoke to Kim a little while ago. In case you guys don't know, Kim is the major domo behind Guitar Interactive and our sister company, Lick Library. Scott Wakenshaw. Hey, Scott's in tune. Hey, Scott, how you doing? Says, hello, mate. Happy New Year. Scott, it's great to have you on board. Scott is my drummer's brother, no less. So, or rather, my drummer is Scott's brother, because Scott's older. David Yates says, I've been impressed with these streams. Oh, I've been so impressed with these streams that I signed up for GI Plus after the last stream. David, it is great to have you on board. I keep calling him Dorian Yates, because I read Dorian Yates in my mind's eye. That is the meathead in me coming out, although I've been in lockdown for the last 10 days, so no meatheading for me. But I'm looking forward to getting back into training very, very soon. David Yates has signed up for GI Plus. You can do the same. We're going to be extending our half-price offer for stream viewers, so you can get 50% off your annual membership. Make 2022 the year that you really capitalize on your guitar playing gains. Who else is tuning in? Verena is here. It's great to have you on board. Hi, Nick, and everyone. Happy New Year 2022. Steve says, hello, everybody. And we've got a whole community here. This is killer. Mark McNish says, happy New Year, guys. I need this lesson to give me, given all the noodling I did last year. Focus, focus, focus. Well, Mark, you know that I am the king of the mindless noodling. So there's an in-joke for you. Hank Staines says, hi, Nick, and a happy new year from Honk. No, Hank, really. I get people's names wrong all the time, but Honk Staines is a killer name for a band. Hank, if your band is not called Honk Staines already, that's what you should call them. Looking forward to some inspiration. Need some help with triads to have memorized patterns. Very interesting. We'll talk about that. That is a really fine place to start. Felipe says, hello, first goal. Don't miss any more of your live sessions. Man, hey, it's great to have you on board. You can always catch these on the replay as well, so fear not if you don't catch them live. Dennis Gully is tuning in from the middle of nowhere in Nebraska. Nebraska is a wide open place. Beautiful part of the world, though. Very, very cool. And I gather have fantastic collegiate football teams. One of those things. Who else do we have? Panu says, hi, everybody. Oh, we got so many. Patrick is tuning in and says, hi, Nick. Happy New Year from Winter, Poland. I can't wait anymore. Let's play. I can't wait anymore either. Let's see. David Yates says, Dorian is better than Locrian, I suppose. Dorian is the best mode, right? I'm actually shooting a course on modes later this month. That's going to be available as part of your GI Plus membership. Who else do we have? Just a couple more. Adam is tuning in, says, greetings all, happy new year. David is tuning in from St. Charles, Illinois in the US, also a very cold place, but yeah, we do like it over there. We've got lots of friends over in the US. It's great to have you on board. Of course, if you are enjoying these streams, don't forget to drop us a like, big thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching on. And of course, the best ways you can support these streams, if that's something you'd like to do, is you can give us a thumbs up, you can drop us a comment. Your comments help the algorithm immensely, and also they keep me thoroughly entertained throughout the course of our little Monday night hang. And the best thing you can do, another really good thing you can do is you can share this with your guitar playing friends. If you feel like they're going to get some use out of these streams, which hopefully they will, this is pretty evergreen stuff that we're going to talk about today. It's not specific to this week. So yeah, share this with your guitar playing friends. But also, you can check out GI Plus. GI Plus is the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive Magazine. And And if you're watching the stream, you can get 50% off your annual membership for the duration of this stream and also for 1 hour afterwards. There's going to be a link in the comments, so keep your eyes in the chat. Don't go get it just yet. You can go and sign up right now, but I would wait until after the stream because we're going to be doing some good stuff today. So anyway, let's get stuck into it. So first things first, let's talk about goal setting and what goals you have and what goals I have for 2022. So what I want to know from you guys is I want you to drop in the comments what your guitar playing goals are for the coming year, because it's New Year. New Year is upon us, and this is around the time that people start making big changes in their life. Maybe you want to get your health and fitness in check. Maybe you want to cut back on drinking or smoking or whatever it is that you do. Maybe you want to spend more time on your hobbies. Maybe you want to improve a skill like playing the guitar. Maybe you want to take a different career path, right? Well, we're going to be talking about all that good stuff, but first I want to know what it is that you guys are wanting to work on. So we already have one. Let me just wind back up. Hank Staines says he's looking for some help with triads and how to memorize patterns. So that's interesting. That is a very cool and very specific goal that we'll talk about. So while you guys are talking about this stuff, while you guys are telling me what it is that you are hoping to develop in your own guitar playing, let's talk about goal setting in general. So one of the big mistakes that people make when it comes to setting goals on the guitar is people set massive goals, absolutely enormous goals, right? Do me a favor, stick your virtual hand in the air. If you ever sat down and thought 2022 or insert year here is my year, I am going to become way better at the guitar this year. Well, if I said to you, imagine you were my teacher and I said, dear teacher, I want to be way better at the guitar. What would you do with that? What would you tell me? Because that is a pretty huge and pretty broad, pretty broad goal. It's a bit too broad to act on, I guess. So maybe what we can do is we can start by talking about the nature of setting good goals. Now, you guys might have seen this already, but there is an acronym that we can use when it comes to setting goals. And the acronym is SMART, S-M-A-R-T, right? S-M-A-R-T. It reads like so, but what it stands for, right, this is very, very specific, is it stands for specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time-based. Now, you may have come across this before, right, but if you haven't, this is gold when it comes to setting your guitar playing goals. So let's take a look at some of the comments we've got already, and we're going to see how well they fit our definition of these SMART goals. So let's get into Matt Burnett, right? Matt Burnett says, learn to legato more and do more weightlifting. I'm also newly unemployed, so find a job first. You don't need to wait. You can do all this stuff at the same time. They don't need to be one on top of the other. First of all, for training, absolutely get on that boat, my man. Heartily recommend Barbell Medicines content if that's something you want to get into. That's a different thing entirely. So learn to legato more. This is interesting because it is quite specific, but it's not like super, super specific. As far as attainable goes, well, we'll come to measurable. So measurable, I guess it's quite measurable. I mean, how would you measure if you were better at legato after a period of time? Well, let's throw a backing track on. Let's just play a little bit. So I guess if for me, let's say, for example, I'm going to use the Led Zeppelin backing track because I do quite like this one. So let's say I was playing away and the majority of my guitar playing or my legato lines, let's say, for example, were limited to short legato lines like this. Something like this. represent, in my mind, a very clearly measurable improvement in Legato. But how do you really gauge that? How do you gauge, this is the M part of our goal setting, this M, this measurable part? Well, I guess probably the best way to measure this would be to film yourself and maybe think about transcribing some of your own solos. So, for example, what you might do, excuse me a moment, did say I've recently had the plague, so I'm going to be doing that and coughing fairly regularly over the course of this stream. So, specific, yes, learn to legato more. That is very cool. It's quite specific. We could make it more specific, but we'll get to that. Measurable, it is absolutely measurable. Attainable, well, based upon what I know about you, Matt, from our conversations on these streams, I would suggest this is an attainable goal. Now, an example of a goal that might be unattainable would be if you would sit down and go, in 2022, I am going to become the greatest legato guitar player in the world. That might be a little much. Certainly not over the course of 2022. I'm not saying it's without the bounds of possibility over the course of your life, but maybe over 2022, that might be a little much. So our goal so far to learn legato more is specific, it is measurable, and it's attainable. So let's get into some more stuff. Relevant. So relevant is interesting, right? Because our relevant goal here, we have two goals here. So we have the goal of do more weightlifting. That'd be an example of a goal that's not necessarily relevant to your guitar playing. Because take it from somebody who's a bit of a meathead, amateur, hobbyist powerlifter, this has had no effect on my guitar playing at all. Zero. Precisely none. So that would be a goal that's irrelevant to my guitar playing. It's a good goal to have, but not relevant to my guitar playing. However, learning to legato more, that is absolutely something that is relevant for your guitar playing. Now, what we are missing is the T, which is time-based. Now, we'll get onto that in just a moment. But we have some more goals. We're going to see if I can give you guys some help with that. So we're going to keep on going. Blue Summerlin says, practice time with the guitar. Make sure I do it. Difficult with work, etc. Now, this is another interesting goal. What else do we have? We've got some more. We've got some very interesting comments from loveface.xyz. Wow, that's not what I expected. iSteve is interested. Work on my timing. Now, that is good and specific. Good and specific. But it's perhaps not as... Well, it's measurable, for sure. It's not time-based. It's definitely relevant. It's definitely attainable. Everybody can work on the timing. Maybe we don't know quite how we're going to do it. So we've got some more stuff on here. Ah, this is interesting. Joe Johnson, guitar player, says, hey, Nick, working on my tone. Any advice on getting the perfect note? Yes, I absolutely do. And we'll get onto that. Here's an interesting one. Gareth Wilkins says, Graham Wilkins, sorry. I have a friend called Gareth Wilkins. Graham Wilkins says, learn an Alan Holdsworth song all the way through. Now, that is cool, right? That is really specific and it's really measurable. Because you know when you've done it. You know when you can play it from start to finish. It's, I would imagine, attainable. That's something only you can say, based. If you've literally just learned G, you know, from, like, yesterday. I know G, I know D, I know C, add 9. Now I'm going to play, I'm going to play some Holdsworth. Maybe a bit much, but here's an interesting one, right? So I think we've touched on something here. Matt Bennett says, those long liquidy lines, that's what I want to do, right? Okay, well, I'm going to give you some tools on how to do that, but what I want you guys to do who have currently given me some guitar playing goals. We got some more guitar playing goals coming in here. Let's see some more. Scott Wakenshaw says, to get my fingers loosened up for trying more solo scale related stuff on the guitar. Interesting. So perhaps getting some more technique together. What I want you guys to do, Marcin has a really good one here. Exploring melodic minor, develop better legato and hand sync. These are very specific. I like that. These are not this whole, get better at guitar thing. So we've got some very specific goals. I'm going to give you guys some tools for doing this in a moment. But if you have commented already, or you're thinking about commenting, what I want you to do, I'm going to play a little bit more for our friend Matt. I'm going to do some more of these liquid type legato lines, then we'll talk about how to develop them. What I want you to do while we're doing this is I'd like you to write in the comments perhaps a revised version of your goal that fits this definition of our SMART analysis. So just to remind you, a SMART analysis is going to be specific. I'm going to write this out so you guys can see it. Specific, I'll try to type this, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time time-based, right? So time-based just means there's a time frame we're going to do it in. What I want you to do is I would like you guys to reframe your goals for me in the comments section. I want you to retype out your specific goals for 2022, but I want you to think about it using these terms. And I want to make sure that your goals are specifically lined out for you using these ideas. And while you do that, I'm going to play just a little bit longer. We're going to do some more of Matt's legato lines, let's say. So let's go back to the Zeppelin backtrack. Let's just see how this sounds. So I'm going to give you guys just a minute to do this. Reframe your goals for me in the comment section using these criteria, and then I'm going to give you some tools. Here we go. Stuck the line in there, just missed it. Okay, so we've got some comments coming in. Let's just take a quick look, and then we're going to give you guys some tools that you can use to achieve your goals. Here we go. Let's see what we've got. Interesting. So we've got some really cool reframings going on here. Matt Burnett says, more specific, improve finger strength. This is interesting. So finger strength is something we'll get back to. Strength is kind of a misleading thing that guitar players come out with quite a lot. I know what you mean. I know exactly what you mean by this. We're going to be very, very specific about this. Here we go. Sacred Godslayer says, my goal is to become fluent and aware with the use of melodic minor and its modes. Wow, Blue Summoning. Ha, here we go. 1 hour a day practice, relevant, don't noodle. That is much better. That is a much better reframing of our goal right there. This is cool. This is critical. Marcine says, learning the modes of melodic minor and jamming. Take legato and left hand sync course. Funnily enough, I've got one of those coming out, but we'll get to that. It'll be available this year for sure. Practice that every day for X amount of time, relevance, life or death importance. I agree. I feel that way too. Here we got a few more. Okay, so Mark McNish, memorize the circle fifths and locate major and minor scales in the fretboard using the E and A strings by the end of June. My man, you've done it. That is a really solid, concrete goal, and it's measurable. This is what we're talking about, right? Hank Staines, on any three strings, play a triad through the key, i.e. C, D minor, E minor, A, F, G, A minor, et cetera, in any key, anywhere, by the end of the year. These are what I'm talking about, right? So these goals, these are concrete, realistic, achievable goals for you guys. Now, when it comes to setting this stuff, this is critical for setting yourself on the path to success, because if I said to you, let's say, for example, I said, hey, I want you to go to the shops and get me some food. And you said, okay, cool, which shop? And I went, oh, no. And you went, well, what food do you like? Oh, no, but it better be the best food I've ever had. Man, just like, hey, that's really, really nebulous. You know, you're not gonna get that. You're not gonna nail that. You're not gonna know that the best food is from Zapatista's Burrito Bar in Newcastle. Absolutely unquestionably the best food. But the best food is actually the chorizo nachos, because, you know, just is. Anyway, I'm rambling. You can tell I haven't eaten in a little while, so I'm thinking about food all the time. But yes, specific goals would be if I said to you, hey, go to Zapatista Burrito Bar in Newcastle, get me the chorizo nachos, bring them here before they get cold. You would go, gotcha, I know exactly what's going on. Now, when it comes to happiness, that's how the missus sends me out to get dinner. Well, you should know, Matt. That's how these things work. You should know what she wants for dinner. On we go. So yeah, these like really super specific goals that we're dealing with here are going to be your guiding locus when it comes to selecting the tools that you use to develop your goals. Now, there's so many ways you can do it, but there are a few basic tools that I'm going to equip you guys with today. We're going to focus on Matt's goal of developing legato, but we could just as easily frame this up with Hank's goal of learning to play more triad ideas. So let's try and do both at once. We'll see if we can do both of those, because you guys have been good enough to give me your goals. We've also had some melodic minor ideas, so hey, let's do that too. Let's see if we can get those, all three of those, cracked all at once. So what I would suggest to you guys that have goals, concrete goals laid out ahead of you, is I would suggest that you write these down and have it somewhere, physically write it down, so you can reference this and you can check off against your goals. You can check it off against your written goal and go, how am I progressing towards my goal? Is there anything that I need to do differently? So let's get into it. So we're going to begin by taking a look at how you might develop your legato guitar playing. So let's say we've established that what we want to develop are longer flowing legato guitar lines. And we want to be able to do them, just to keep it specific, let's say we want to be able to develop long flowing guitar lines using the melodic minor scale. Now, this is something that's going to require a few things first of all. So we're going to require, first of all, the ability to actually play legato guitar lines full stop. So if what's happening is when it's time to play, if you're setting out playing legato and you get this, that's no good, right? That is going to stop us from developing lines, because we're not actually able to play anything legato with that approach. So we're going to need that in place first of all. Secondly, for melodic minor to work, we're going to need to know what notes are in melodic minor, and we're going to need to know how we can find them. So I guess a good place to start would be with a familiar key. So maybe we could start with the idea of taking Dorian. Now, it's my contention that Dorian and melodic minor are basically the same. So we know the idea of Aeolian and harmonic minor being related to each other. So, like, for example, harmonic minor, let's take just a single position. So for example, if we took Aeolian, and we took this idea of playing 1, 2, flat 3, 4, 5, flat 6, flat 7, we know that all we need to do is convert this note into this note to get harmonic minor. And if we didn't, that's how you do it. So that is harmonic minor in a nutshell. Now, melodic minor is that, only instead of starting with Aeolian, we start with Dorian. So if we start with the Dorian scale, we play 1, 2, flat 3, 4, 5, natural 6, flat 7, and then root. And then we take the 7s and we raise them, much like we did in our harmonic minor example. Now we have melodic minor. So with that in mind, what we could do is we could essentially start thinking about our melodic minor as like a harmonic Dorian, if you want to call it that way. That's maybe a slightly cheeky way of referring to it, but that's certainly a way that I thought about it when I started getting into melodic minor, because I, you know, I'm very familiar with Dorian. I can improvise in the Dorian mode to the ends of the earth, but the melodic minor took a bit of getting into. So what I started doing was something like this. What I would do is I would improvise, and I would take the idea of playing Dorian lines. So this works in Dorian, and anytime Dorian works, you can normally shoehorn melodic minor in, and it sounds pretty good. So for example, if I took this Dorian idea, let's just take this little top portion there. What I would do is I would take these Dorian ideas, and I'd look for sevenths, which are D notes in this case, from the key B, and I'd raise them. So there, for example, seven. Here's the sharp seven. And what I would do while I was doing that is I would assess, as I was playing, I would assess whether I was nailing it or not. So if I was getting the sevenths, I would make a mental note and go, hey, you got it. That's where that is. If I played something that was, like, if I raised the wrong note, let's say, for example, I raised the third, I'd make a mental note and go, ah, no, that was the third. That was the wrong note. What I would do if I missed it, if I played the natural seven instead, I'd go, oh, okay, that's the natural seven. That still sounds pretty good. But what we want is the raised seven. Now, what I'm doing here is something that I refer to as the structured improvisation approach. Learning stuff. So I set myself the goal of improvising with an outcome in mind, and the outcome in mind was to take lines that I'm familiar with in Dorian and rework them to be melodic minor. But because I'm doing it in real time, because I'm not sitting down and working it out, I'm not sitting down and going, here's a Dorian lick that I like. Going, okay, let's melodic minorize it. Because I wasn't doing that, it forced me to reach for this stuff, kind of make these adjustments in real time, which is how you'd be doing it in the real world anyway. You'd be going from something like Dorian, which would be your go-to, over a minor chord and going, ah, I must adjust this to melodic minor. So the other side of this is I never really sat down and learned a bunch of melodic minor scale shapes. So I never really sat down and went, I must learn the scales for this. I must learn the shapes for this, because I was already pretty familiar with how Dorian worked together. And what I was really more interested in having was a series of pathways that I could use to get through the melodic minor. So instead of sitting and learning every shape and going, okay, E melodic minor, I must begin here, and I must start with this one. And so on and so forth. Because I didn't do that, I do actually know them all, but I learned them all because I kind of made these connections through improvising. I was much more interested in being able to go, okay, I'm playing an E. I'd like to be able to drop some melodic minor into this. That was much more interesting to me. So I kind of skipped the middleman and went, I'm going to go straight to doing this. Now, this structured improvisation framework is actually also really useful, really, really super useful. Ah, says thanks for the awesome tip, says Marcine. Ah, I'm guessing this is regarding the Melodic Minor. And Sacred Godslayer says the same. There we go. That is my little kind of like way of thinking about the Melodic Minor. Ah, here's interesting. Shulam Melodic Minor is different ascending than descending, says Hank Staines. Now, this depends on a few things. If you're a classical musician, it is. But if you're a contemporary musician, we don't use the two different forms. We don't use the ascending and descending form because the descending form is the same as the natural minor scale. It's the same as the Aeolian scale. And we already have a scale for that. Now, the reason the melodic minor even exists in the first place is because composers wanted this interval going up and this interval going down. Wants people to go. And one at this interval. On the way down, because it sounds very, very dramatic. The apocryphal story, I don't know how true this is, but the apocryphal story is that singers didn't like this big interval. Yeah. Sounded a bit strange. It's also possible that, you know, trends towards melodies at the time didn't like those big jumps that we get in harmonic minor. So the way that was kind of like circumnavigated was by changing things up so that on the way up, we would get a smooth transition up to this dramatic interval. And then on the way down, we get a smooth transition down. Now that is where the ascending and descending forms of melodic minor come from, but they're not very useful to us as contemporary musicians because, like I say, the descending form is just the Aeolian scale and we can use that anyway. So you could, if theoretically, you could play one scale in ascent and one scale in descent, so you could easily play something like this. For example, if I threw the melodic minor back track back on, and let's say I played melodic minor on the way up and Aeolian on the way down, that'd be easy enough. We do that, that works, but it's not really the sound that we're looking for when we play melodic minor, that kind of very, very jazz kind of way of doing things. So this is a distinction worth making. And I actually think this stops a lot of guitar players from really getting into the world of melodic minor, so to speak, I think anyway. So yeah, that's a little kind of like apocryphal story for you. So let's take this structured improvisation tool and let's flip this on its head. Let's turn it into our legato thing. Because legato is another thing people have come up with. People want to get better at the legato. And also there was talk of timing. Now, timing is another interesting thing. I'm going to rip off Tom Quayle here for a moment, as I do with so many things, because Tom's come up with a load of great stuff. If I'm not ripping off Nick Harrison's ideas or Troy Grady's ideas, it's Tom Quayle's ideas. I have a few of my own, I promise. But yeah, anyway, so there's two of me. Let's go to this one. So legato, let's go back here, right? Now, in terms of developing longer legato ideas, I guess probably the easiest way to do it is to actually just look for long legato ideas that work for you. But if you don't know what they are, well, where do you go to find them? Do you learn a bunch of licks? Well, you guys will know I'm not a huge fan of learning a bunch of licks. I prefer to discover ways that you like to play through certain scales or certain ideas. So that's probably the way that I would approach it. So what I would do is I would take my legato and I'd slow it down to a point where I could consciously think about the lines that I'm playing and consciously look for ways to get through bigger, longer legato lines. Now, for example, what that might look like is something like this. So instead of playing these long lines at speed, what I might do is I might play it like so. Trying to do is look for places that I think it's cool to go to. It's right here. be an interesting way to do that. So what happens there is, over a period of time, these sort of lines just start to creep into your plane. They start to appear in places that you didn't necessarily expect to find them. It's a bit like if you you know, if you learn a word, you can tell when somebody's learned a cool word because it just crops up in conversation all the time. So for example, let's take the word specificity, which is a cool word. If you learn the word specificity because it relates to what we're talking about today, and you go specificity, and then you would, let's say for example, you're out shopping for shoes, and then you see you see a pair of shoes that are going to look great at this wedding that you're going to, and you go, hey, these are great. You know, these are, I'm probably never wearing them again, but they're really great for this wedding I'm going to. Hey, how about that for specificity? And it comes out. You go, oh, I didn't even realize I was going to say that. This stuff crops up in your guitar playing in a similar kind of way. So you would develop these little pathways. You'd be looking for little roots through the scale. But then when you come to actually play, when it comes to actually improvise musically, and you switch that thinking part of your brain off, they just appear. So for example, if I was to do that, let's say I went to the end of my session and went, okay, I'm just gonna have a little play now, see what's happening. What I could do is I could just play freely, and maybe some ideas like this would come out. So on. Now, people ask me this fairly regularly when I say, hey, let's talk about this structured improvisation thing. They go, well, that's cool, but how do I actually translate this into my guitar playing? Well, the answer is that you don't. It just, you do it, you do this improvisation, and then in time, when you are ready, it just happens. It just appears in your guitar playing. So that's how I would develop longer legato lines, but that's just one tool that you might use. Another example might be Hank's triads, for example. So if we were doing Hank's triads, let's say for example, we'll put a different backing track on because I'm kind of sick of that one now. Let's maybe say we were going to do the blues rock one that I did at the start. So that might be this. So we're in the key of C. Much fun as that track is, I could sit and noodle on all day, but if for example I wanted to get in the habit of using triads over that, what I would do is I would take the idea of maybe selecting a couple of triads and trying to improvise around those. So maybe what I might do is I might take a pair, I might take the idea of C and B flat, that kind of works. It's deliciously country if you play like that. What I might do is I might try and look for locations where I could play those. And maybe I'd allow myself the chromatic passing in between. And I'd look for places where I could play that sort of thing. important thing with this is all the time when I'm doing this, I'm trying to make music with this stuff. I'm not putting any steps in between, you know, the sitting down to improvise and the musical result. Everything I'm doing is in time, it's done to a backing track, and it's done with some kind of musical idea that I'm going for. I'm trying to put a little rhythmic idea on something, let's say, or I'm trying to articulate things in a musical sort of fashion, just trying to not make this super mechanical. Now, what you can do is you can start looking for other patterns and places that you maybe wouldn't necessarily instantly reach for, and if you do this for a long period of time, you'll start doing that anyway. So for example, if I said to you, hey, just play me these two triads for an hour, man, you would find some more places to play these triads, let me tell you, just to stave off boredom, you'd find it. So that is one resource you can look for. But let's talk about some other resources that you can find. So other resources you can reach for, you can reach for courses. There are some great courses that are available out there, and locating a course that works for you is, man, we're, it's 2022, they're all over the place. We have a bunch of them at GI Plus. If you're interested in the Legato thing, Tom's got some killer stuff on there. I have a technique course coming out very, very soon. We're also going to be doing a kind of guide to picking, because we've done the picking strategies thing. That was a great success. So we'll be doing that. I'm doing a modal, like a full modal course that should be available in February, I would imagine. So we got a bunch of courses. We're going to be releasing kind of one a month for the next year. They're all kind of coming out. So if you want to get on the membership train, now is the time to do it. Remember, you can get 50% off your annual membership over the course of this stream and for 1 hour afterwards. Another thing that you might do is you might consider seeking out a teacher. So a teacher is really cool, but it doesn't have to be a formal teacher. It can just be a guitar playing friend, someone that you can reference off and maybe get some kind of some feedback from. So peer feedback is really important, because the next question with this one is, how do you actually measure if you're getting any better at this stuff? You can say, I feel like I'm getting better. And that is very valuable. That's super valuable, because if you feel like you're getting better, then you probably are. But if you're not sure, it can be useful to reference that against someone else. So it can be useful to take somebody you know and maybe say to them, hey, look, I'm working on this stuff. Can I bounce some ideas off you? You know, maybe record it on your phone, send it to a friend and get some feedback. You can always upload it and tag us in it, and I'd be happy to give you some feedback anytime you like. I would love to do that stuff for you guys. I'd love to see you play. So upload it, tag us. We'd love to see it. Another way that you can measure your progress is you can video yourself and you can reference back across a period of time. So you can video yourself at the end of a month, let's say, and you could set yourself the task of playing something and then film it again a month later and reference it and go, hey, is this any better? Because then you'll know if what you're doing is working. And if it's working, keep doing it. If it's not working, well, change it. There's lots of other ways you can do this. So we've gone on and on and on over this stuff. We do have a Q&A to do. So what I want from you guys is drop me some questions. I'm really feeling this backing track, so I'm going to play a little bit more. I'll do a little bit more stuff with triads too, just because that's quite a lot of fun. I'm going to play some more for you guys. What I want you to do while we're doing this, just drop me some questions in the Q&A, and then I will answer them on the flip side. So drop your questions below. Remember, you can get 50% off your annual membership for 1 hour after the stream. Code will be in the comments. So look for the comments on this stream. It's going to be in there. You can get your 50% off. It's going to be available for 1 hour and no longer after the stream. You can access it here. So that's your link. It'll be available for 1 hour after this stream. So get your GI Plus memberships. There's loads of great stuff on there. I'm going to play a little bit, and then I'm going to get you guys to fire me some questions. So drop your questions in the comments below. Drop your questions in the comments. I will be answering them in the live Q&A after this little bit of mindless noodling, let's say. So let's do it. Here we go. Just about stuck the landing there, so we got it the second time round. All right, let's turn our attention to your questions. We've got some great questions in already. We're going to answer them in the time we've got left. We've got about 10 minutes. I will go a little bit longer because I wasn't here last week and I missed you guys, so we'll go a little longer. Here we go. Let's see what's come in. We've got some other really good ones. Ah, some comments. Matt Burnett, I was playing over a vamping backing track last night and really surprised me with some of the lines I started playing after I ran out of my usual licks. This is true, actually. Sometimes you just need to play all the stuff that you play all the time and just get it out of the way before you start really searching for new and creative stuff. So sometimes time can be really useful. Just spending like an extended period of time working over a track can really, really be useful. That's why our tracks are like, our tracks are all like 10 minutes long. So if you want to get access to the backing tracks we're using today, they're available to GI Plus members to download and keep. But of course, you can watch them on the GI YouTube. If you're not subscribed already, do so. It will let you know whenever we put out new videos, which are super regular. New backing tracks coming every week this year as well. So we've got a new one coming on Friday. They are going to be available for you guys again every week. So yes, get on the backing tracks. Anyway, let's keep on going. So we got some great questions coming in. Here we go. Matt Burnett again says, I record myself every couple of months to compare. That's a very good idea. Blue Summerlin, recording myself daily helps me. I absolutely agree with this, right? There's nothing better. I feel really vain because, and I'm also very lucky because the line of work I'm in, I get to see myself on video all the time. So I get to reference my own playing and go, is this good or is this bad? It felt good at the time. Not so sure about that. Do you know where I'm coming from? So I get to watch this stuff. I get to make judgments in real time and make improvements in my playing based on what I'm seeing. I get to watch these streams back, which is kind of cool. So I watch all my videos. Very, very vain. But it's really just to see, you know, like, what would I change? What went well? What didn't go so well? Same as listening to concert footage, I guess. So if you record yourself playing, if you're gigging and then you record the gig, you can listen back and go, that was good, that was less good. If you don't record, you have no reference. You will never know. So anyway, on we go. More questions. So Graham Wilkins says, how many of the notes are you picking in the legato line? This is an important question, right? So it depends. It depends. The real answer is it depends what kind of sound I'm going for. If I want kind of a little bit of that sound, that crunchy, crunchy, crunchy sound in there, like maybe something like this, for example, track on real quick because the track's cool. If I want something with a little bit more, then I'll pick more notes. If I want it to be super, super smooth, I'll use finger as I can, whichever hand that's on. So it could be hybrid picking, it could be hammer-on from nowhere. In honesty, something I've kind of strived towards with the legato thing is being able to do it all without having to use my right hand at all. Or if I do use the right hand, just using hybrid picking just to get that brush kind of sound. Now, the reason I've chosen to do this, Graham, is because what I want is I want the ability to not have that sound that you get from a plectrum, but be able to dial that in by picking more notes. So I'm not picking to get the note sound, if that makes sense. I'm picking it as an effect, so it's a textural thing. If I feel like the line needs a bit of, if it needs some lumps in the soup, so to speak, then if it needs some croutons in there, then I'll throw some pick notes in. I've said before, you know, picking doesn't really have a sound beyond like this economy picking, alternate picking thing. So there are really two sounds you can make on the guitar. There is the sound of a finger hitting the string, which is this, or it's this finger, or this finger, or this finger, or your thumb, or whatever. There's the sound of fingers, and there is the sound of plastic, which is the sound of plectrum. They're both cool sounds, and you need both in your repertoire. We know this already. In terms of the way you want your lick to sound, that's the argument for being able to play licks, both legato and picked, and some combination of the two. However, sometimes convenience is a thing. So sometimes what I'll do if I'm playing a really, really challenging line with lots of big string skips, I will use more picking and more hybrid picking, as opposed to trying to legato my way through that and trying to get those really clean string crosses. Sometimes that can be a pain in the proverbial. If, for example, I was playing something like this. Richie Kotzen thing that I like to do a lot, that I will use more picking than I would necessarily expect if I wanted it to sound super legato, just because it's a total pain to execute that without, I guess I could do thumb and fingers, but that's one of the things. So yeah, the answer really is, it sounds like a really pretentious answer, but it depends how picky I want the line to sound. Hopefully that's answered your question. It's a very good question, though. I do like that. Here's a really great question. Joe Johnson, guitar player. Any tips on how to get the axe to really sing? Man, when I find out, I'll tell you. No, I'm joking. So, I hope so anyway. In terms of getting the guitar to really sing, few things. First of all, in terms of sing, when we say we want the guitar to sing, what I would maybe say most people mean by that is making the guitar sound like a singer. So making the guitar sound vocal. Now, lots of guitar players are great at this. Derek Trucks is phenomenal at this, but so is David Gilmour. So it's not exclusively a slide thing. Steve Vai is just a wonderful vocal guitar player. It's just not necessarily vocal in that blues derived sense. It's a different kind of vocal thing, but it sounds like sometimes somebody being tickled and sometimes somebody being tortured, but even still it sounds like somebody singing. So that's part of it. So part of that is vibrato, and part of that is having the right arc on your notes. But I guess the real question here, because you mentioned getting the perfect note before, is your right hand touch. Now your right hand touch interacts with the guitar in a very interesting way, and I generally find lighter is better for singing notes. Let me show you what I'm talking about. So let me throw this back on. I'm really feeling this backtrack, so we'll stick with this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to play some very, very hard notes and then some very light notes. Joe, I'm going to get through the questions so everybody can see what's going on here, but let's try hitting these notes really hard. Getting at here, Joe, is there is a sweet spot for touch. and it's often on the lighter side of things, especially if you want to get the guitar really blossoming and blooming with these big wide open notes that evolve as you play them. So the cool thing about this is because these notes evolve, if you're playing with lots of distortion or enough distortion to really make the note carry, you play with a relatively light touch, the note evolves and blooms as you apply your vibrato to it. Whereas if I really lay into this note, it does have a bit of that, but I play a little softer. Just has a little bit more of that blossom going on that I'm really into. So that is kind of where I'd start with this. I'd maybe start with a slightly lighter touch then, because guitar players tend, especially dudes, we tend to get really aggressive with the guitar. For some reason, there's this idea that the guitar is a strength thing and that we should be playing really hard with all of our might, and the guitar should be set up in such a way that it is a challenge to our manly strength. And like, nah, leave that for the deadlifts. Like, deadlifts, yes, guitar, not so much. So yeah, hopefully that's gonna help. Hank is come back on a chord change. Do you have any preference on landing on a tone, i.e. root, third, or whatever? Yeah, it depends what kind of thing I'm going for. So root feels really affirmative. It's like, I have bop, I have nailed this change. Same with fifths. Fifths feel very, psh, I've nailed this. Thirds are a little sweeter sounding. When we get into upper extensions, we start to end up sounding a little more fusion, I guess. I used this example on our fusion streams recently. So let me just show you some quick stuff on this. I'm going to throw the YouTube fusion backing track on. This is our Tom Quayle style backing track. Chord changes are A-7, C-7, D-7, F-7. Now, I'm going to start by landing on roots and fifths, and listen to how like rock it sounds when I do this, right? So I'm going to land on roots and fifths as we go to the changes. Big long intro on this one. I'm gonna let you hear. Seventh there by accident. I got distracted by my own lack of in-tuneness. But you guys can hear how affirmative that is. Now what I'm going to do next is, once I've tuned up, I'm going to do the same thing. This time what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and land on ninths and elevenths. Right, so ninths would be the same as the second, eleventh would be the same as the fourth. So here we go. I guess probably a way to think about this is the further up the extensions you go, the more adventurous your choices are going to sound. So I guess if you're trying to sound like super rocktastic, maybe don't hit the fourths all the time, or don't land on the 13ths so much. But if you want to get a bit of that fusionness in there, that's a cool choice. So there's not really a right or wrong way to do this. There's not really a right or wrong note to choose. It just depends. Depends on what you're going for. So if you want a slightly more ambiguous, slightly more, like I say, fusion-y type sound, or clever type sound, maybe think about landing on the upper extensions, like the 7ths, 9ths, 13ths, etc. If you want something a bit more firm, a bit more positive, a bit more, yes, Maybe think about roots, fifths, thirds, cool too. So we got some more. A friend Greg tuning in on Facebook says, do you have any suggestions on how to stay focused and avoid mind wandering distractions after a hard day at the office? Forget the problems of the day that passed and really stay focused. Yes, I do. Yes, I absolutely do. So what I would suggest is, first of all, make your practice time bound. So set yourself timers and say, I'm going to practice for 45 minutes and it's going to be in units of 15 minutes. So I'm going to do 15 minutes, then I'm going to take a break. Then I'm going to do 15 minutes, then I'm going to take a break, then 15 minutes. I wouldn't suggest doing long practice sessions and expecting yourself to stay focused without rotating activities. But you can focus on a single thing for a whole 45 minutes or an hour if you break it up with little breaks. And during that time, set yourself a goal. So be goal-oriented with what you're playing. So for example, what I was doing there, and you notice me probably get lost in the weeds with this stuff, what I was doing is I was going, okay, I am going to hit ninths and fourths. Or ninths and elevenths, as we go on this one. That's how I'm going to hit these changes. So I'm going to play these changes. I'm going to hit ninths. I'm going to hit fourths and seconds, basically. Ninths and elevenths. So I might play. I could stay focused on that for an extended period of time because it's goal driven. And then if I set myself an amount of time to work on that and then move away from it, that kind of helps me with the old focus. So setting goals is really, really important, and making them time bound for your practice sessions, not having a million, not just having I'm going to practice until I get bored. It's a bad idea. Practice for a certain amount of time. You can then play until you get bored if you like. But set yourself a thing to work on specifically and a short period of time to do it in. That's how I would do that. So a couple more. Patrick says, when you play so fast, do you think about what you play or just feel the music? I try hard not to think what I'm playing. I'll maybe have an idea in mind. I'll have a flow of a little bit. Let's say, for example, that sounds really ridiculous, right? Imagine if it was just a video of me going like, a little bit. There's an in-joke. The people who know what's going on. Woodla woodla wa. Anyway, so I'll tell you more about that another time. So I try not to think about that because when I start thinking about stuff, I start second guessing myself, and that's not a good place to be when you're playing music. However, when I'm practicing, I do think very intently about what I'm playing, and I'm analyzing it as I'm going. So kind of a bit of both. Mark McNish says, I found it difficult to light my right hand without also lightening my right hand picking. Is there something I can do to mentally separate the two? Kinda, but I would probably say that lightening your picking might not be a bad thing. So potential. Hey, my boy John is in. Simple goal for 2022. Gig. Yes. John is my bandmate. Gigs in 2022. Please, can we? I would love to. I'd like to get this album out as well, John. We'll get on that. So yeah, we're going to release some music for you guys. Hey, 2022 is the year. So going back to that, I found it difficult to lighten my right hand. So yeah, I mean, you absolutely can practice doing one and not the other. It is totally possible. I would probably say maybe don't worry so much about it. Lightening up your picking might not be a bad thing. Unless you don't like the sound of it, in which case, hey, you know what to do. You can practice it. So anyway, let's keep on going. Have a great year, says Ivan. How about chapters of sweep picking? Ooh, interesting. Now, sweep picking is something that I kind of fell into. I never really sat and worked on it terribly, but I kind of fell into the idea of doing some sweep picking. Maybe I'll do something on that. That's a really great suggestion. So, guys, we've already run 10 minutes over time. Just a quick reminder for you all. If you haven't done so already, you can sign up for your GI Plus annual membership. You can get 50% off your annual membership. That is a ludicrous discount for one whole hour after this stream. After that, it'll be closed. So if you're watching this on the playback, apologies, it's gone. But we'll be running off this again soon. So if you want to get an annual membership, now's the time to do it. Code will be in the description. Guys, I'm going to sign off. Thank you so much for having me. Happy New Year to all of our viewers. It's been great having you on board. We'll be back with another topic. We're going to be discussing some technique ideas and what it means to have good technique and how you might go about getting it in the next few streams. But for the time being, I will bid you adieu. I'm really feeling this backing track, so I'm going to play a little bit more on it. I'll do the Fusion one. Why not? The Fusion one's good fun, so I'm going to play on that. My name's Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Get your GI Plus memberships fast. They are going to be gone in an hour's time. I will see you guys on the flip side. Next Monday, I will be healthy and in fine voice and all that good stuff. We'll be talking about technique and all that good magical music stuff. I'll see you guys next week. Thanks for having me. Here's some Fusion. I'm going to play with the idea of landing on those ninths and those 11ths because I'm really feeling that. Here we go. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from Fusion Maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done?
Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.